Please join together in singing number 416, Church of God, Elect and Glorious, number 416.
Giving thanks to Almighty God for this place consecrated from the work of human hands in 1934, restored last year, and serving all these years as the place here, not only where we gather, where he is glorified. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare to celebrate the sacred mysteries on this solemn feast.
Lord Jesus, you show us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You give us the consolation of the truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You lead us to fullness of life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord,
mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life.
Amen. Glory to God.
O God, who year by year renew for us the day when this your holy temple was consecrated, hear the prayers of your people, and grant that in this place, for you there may always be pure worship, and for us fullness of redemption. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. The angel brought me back to the entrance of the temple, and I saw water flowing out from beneath the threshold of the temple toward the east. For the facade of the temple was toward the east. The water flowed down from the southern side of the temple, south of the altar. He led me outside by the north gate and around to the outer gate facing the east, where I saw water trickling from the southern side. He said to me, "This water flows into the eastern district down upon the Arabah and empties into the sea, the salt waters, which it makes fresh. Wherever the river flows, every sort of living creature that can multiply shall live, and there shall be abundant fish. For wherever this water comes, the sea shall be made fresh. Along both banks of the river, fruit trees of every kind shall grow. Their leaves shall not fade, nor their fruit fail. Every month they shall bear fresh fruit, for they shall be watered by the flow from the sanctuary. Their fruit shall serve for food, and their leaves for medicine." The word of the Lord.
Let us go rejoicing to the house.
reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, you are God's building. According to the grace of God given to me, like a wise master builder, I lay the foundation, and another is building upon it. But each one must be careful how he builds upon it, for no one can lay a foundation other than the one that is there, namely, Jesus Christ. Do you not know that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For the temple of God, which you are, is holy. The word of the Lord.
Since the Passover of the Jews was near, Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and he found in the temple area those who sold oxen, sheep, and doves, as well as the money changers seated there. He made a whip out of cords and drove them all out of the temple area with the sheep and oxen, and spilled the cords of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Take these out of here and stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples recall the words of Scripture, "Zeal for your house will consume me." At this, the Jews answered and said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said, "This temple's been under construction for 46 years. You will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. And therefore, when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered he had said this, and they came to believe the Scripture and the word Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The beautiful Scriptures for today's feast bring before us a sampling of the many images that come to mind and heart, and the connections between what we say of the church as a physical structure, what we say of the body of Christ himself, and what we say of ourselves. For as St. Paul told us in the second reading, you are the dwelling place of God. And so just as we can say that a physical church, a building, is never to be treated common, but always with great reverence and respect, never forgetting the Lord lives here, not just while we're having Mass, but at all times, the Lord dwells here. And yet so often today, churches are treated as, though they're so common, with no respect whatsoever. And yet, isn't it interesting? I think it finds a parallel in society. Paul urges us to respect the body, which is the temple of the Spirit. That's treated with no respect whatsoever, and terrible dishonor. And so as we take a commonality to our own bodies, no wonder it even carries over to the house of the church. From Ezekiel, the prophet sees that from the temple of the Lord would flow water. Water, as we know, is the symbol of grace, of God's love poured out. St. Paul would refer to the Holy Spirit as God's love poured out into our hearts. Water that cleanses. Water that helps things to grow and sustains them. Water that is essential for life. At the dedication anniversary of a church, we think of the flowing water that has been in this holy place, cleansing, renewing, sustaining. And we give thanks. And the scriptures show very few occasions where Jesus seems to lose it, but today's gospel is one of them, and it's when his Father's house is treated as common and with disrespect. So anytime I go, or I make the directives I do, it's because I wish to have said of me what Jesus quoted in the gospel. Zeal for your house consumes me. We can never show greater reverence than we strive each time to do, that we enter this holy place. As I said to you many times, the church building in itself speaks to us and reminds us of this wonderful God who took flesh. If it weren't for Mary's yes, we would not have the incarnation, God becoming flesh. Had he not come in flesh and blood and walked this earth for 3 years, but then ascended to the Father, not see you later, but who then continues to be the incarnate Lord in his word, in his church which he formed, and most especially in his sacraments, and par excellence, in the most blessed of all sacraments, the Holy Eucharist, in which he gives us himself. And so very much we think of the incarnation within the church. And the architecture of this church, when it was dedicated, was all to point toward that reality. When we come to the doors of a church, where is our mind? It shouldn't be carrying on a conversation with whoever we've been talking to up the sidewalk. We stop. We stop. Gaze upon those doors, for they are meant to be the reminder of the one day, the gates of heaven. For what we do here is the closest we get to God this side of the grave. What a difference that would make. In the way we open the door, the way we close the door. It would remind us all the time of that great invitation we have, and that God's not waiting for us above and beyond, but he wants to encounter us here. A true appreciation for the doors of a church then set us up to not miss anything else. As we enter our church, we bless ourselves with holy water, and we almost trip over the baptismal font at the door, since it is baptism that was the door, the entry for us to not come here as strangers, but as children of God. It's most appropriate that holy water be at the doors, and in many churches, such as here on our sides and in our angels, but here the holy water is also in the font. Because no matter where it's located, it's our reclaiming of our baptismal dignity. If we choose to use holy water going out, that's our commitment to live that dignity as we walk out those doors. We notice close proximity to the baptismal font our confessionals, where the Lord who cleanses us of all sin in baptism, original sin if we are but an innocent child, and all sin if we're baptized as an adult, we're not then left, and the next time we fail, we're cut off, but rather that grace can be restored in the sacrament of penance. Hence the church says, it is most ideal that the places we encounter mercy be in close proximity to the baptismal font. It's the case here in our church. As we make our way up the aisle, we see before us the holy place that is never treated as common. In the restoration of our church by the changing of the flooring, it is very obvious that this is a place set apart, because we forget and we take for granted. And so in the choice, we're meant to bring that home. We encounter here the symbol of Christ himself on the altar. He offered the sacrifice of the cross in his own flesh. He was the altar. He's the one who made the offering. He's the priest. And he is what is offered. So he's the lamb of sacrifice. Church says ideally the altar should be made of stone, the firm foundation that is Christ in his church. And in ours, it is. We gaze at the ambo of the pulpit, the place from which we don't have to say, well, who's right? What's going on? Well, currently now, people used to believe what they believe. The place that is like the lighthouse, where the truth is proclaimed and preached. Just gazing at the pulpit, we give thanks to God, who left us that consistency of truth through the magisterium of his church and the great gift of sacred scripture. At the pinnacle of the sanctuary, the one who dwells among us. Why, this isn't just a gathering place, but the one who dwells among us. Why, it's open all day so that we can come before him there in the tabernacle. And just as in the old covenant, the veil was a sign of the presence, so the veil reminds us he is present there. And just as we hear in the Old Testament, when they were journeying and they would put the Ark of the Covenant in a tent, they would have fire burning near it, the sanctuary lamp that is continually renewed and spends itself giving testimony to his presence here. In the center, the hovering Holy Spirit that reminds us that we can know the truth, that we can have bread and wine change into the body and blood of Christ because of the Holy Spirit that was poured out and that continually is poured out. And in a few moments, the bells will remind us of that moment as I extend my hands and invoke that transformative power of the Holy Spirit. Changes bread and wine into Eucharist, enlightens our minds to the truth, and strengthens us beyond what otherwise would be possible. Those are essentials in every church, and yet in ours, in the recent restoration that highlighted what was already here, but all beiged over, we're reminded of these awesome gifts. We look up in the sanctuary, and we're reminded of the song of the angels. Book of Revelation tells us that they are constantly around the throne of the Lamb, singing Sanctus, 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 holy, holy, holy. Revelation on the front wall. St. Luke tells us that to humble shepherds, angels announced good news of great joy, the incarnation, that God was now among us, and their song was Gloria, as is inscribed in our choir loft. We are surrounded by the angels hovering. For in the sacred liturgy, we don't simply look at the angels who guard us, but what we do is we join them in their ceaseless song of praise around the throne of the Lamb. And very beautifully and symbolically, the stars of heaven come down here in the sanctuary to remind us that at Mass, Jesus is not above and beyond, but comes and is present among us. These angels, bear a banner saying Ave Maria, Hail Mary, the words of Gabriel, honoring Mary because she was chosen and she consented by her yes, and so the word became flesh. We would not be here to celebrate this Eucharistic sacrifice if it weren't for that yes. This church was dedicated to the Immaculate Conception, that wonderful event of Mary being preserved from all original sin so that she would be able to say yes, so she would be that pure dwelling place. And so throughout the church, the angels bear those words. And throughout this entire church, in the windows of the doors, in the upper windows, in the custom candlesticks on the high altar, in the carvings of the marble on the altar, throughout the church, it seems it's easier to see them than it is to not see them, but even the ends of the pews, which each contain a piece of the old pews, and those pieces have on them the same symbol that is everywhere, the fleur-de-lis, the symbol of Our Lady, the flower from which the blossom comes, a symbol of the wonder of the Incarnation. And it is the incarnate Lord that we come here to receive in word and in sacrament. So indeed, the church reminds us of an encounter with a living God and reminds us of how we respond and never take for granted that gift. And certainly it bears various shrines that let us know that we're not alone in this journey. We express our dependence or gratitude to God in the kindling of votive candles. And these, even when we walk into church, remind us of the faith of others. I never come in this church without glancing at the candles and offering a prayer for all those who kindled them. And so on this day of the anniversary of dedication, may we appreciate anew the sacredness of this place, the richness of its symbols, but most especially, the great gift it points to. For the church is more than a building, it's us. It was expressed magnificently in the opening hymn of Mass this evening. And in conclusion, I remind you of parts. First, the command. Church of God, you, me, elect and glorious, be the people he intends. Then later we sang, know the purpose of your calling, show to all God's mighty deeds. Tell of love which knows no limits, grace which meets all human needs. It's the message of mercy. It's the reason for our outreach. When we look at the confessional, we think of the line we just sang, God has called you out of darkness. When we look at the pulpit, turned your blindness into sight. When we look to the altar, on which is represented the sacrifice of Calvary, let all find fresh hope and purpose in Christ Jesus crucified. And we are sent from this place and from Mass day after day, summed up beautifully in the concluding line we sang. Give your life in joyful service. Sing his praise, his love declare. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Standing in his holy presence, with trust, grounding our hearts, we bring our needs.
For the Church, the body of Christ, that all our efforts to spread the gospel be built upon Jesus as the cornerstone and be carried out through the diversity of the many living stones that we are in our gifts and talents. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our children, may they see authentic examples of what it means to be a follower of Jesus in their homes and in the life of our parish community, thus coming to understand what it means to be church and not simply go to church. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all life to be defended, cherished, and protected without condition or compromise, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who seldom, if ever, practice their Catholic faith, may they experience the Lord anew in this place and among us, and enrich our lives with theirs shared with us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our departed loved ones, especially Father James Brennan, who built this church, and for Manny Chavez, for whom this Mass is offered, and for all those who built up the Catholic community here in Portsmouth in a diversity of ways and places over these many years, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the needs we carry here in our hearts today, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
all this we ask confidently through Christ our Lord.
Please sing together One Heart, One Mind, found in the inside cover of your hymnal, worship aid number 3, One Heart, One Mind, worship number 3.
All that we are, we hold in common.
Pray, brethren, my sacrifice and yours be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. Recalling the day when you were pleased to fill your house with glory and holiness, O Lord, we pray that you may make of us a sacrificial offering always acceptable to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For in this visible house that you have let us build, and where you never cease to show favor to the family on pilgrimage to you in this place, you wonderfully manifest and accomplish the mysteries of your communion with us. Here you build up for yourself the temple that we are, and cause your church spread throughout the world to grow ever more and more as the Lord's own body, till she reaches her fullness in the vision of peace, the heavenly city of Jerusalem. And so, with the countless ranks of the blessed, in the temple of your glory we praise you, we bless you, and proclaim your greatness as we acclaim. Sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord.
wine, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, and Peter, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who've fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy, and welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who've pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us pray. May the people consecrated to you, O Lord, we pray, receive the fruits and joy of your blessing, that the festive homage they have offered you today in the body may redound upon them as a spiritual gift through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I want to thank so many of you who reached out with such support after last Sunday's report and message about our capital campaign status. The extra effort envelopes were all gone, so we did put a few more. If you didn't have an opportunity and you want one, please take one from the baskets at the door. If you missed the message, there's details in the bulletin. Don't forget, next Sunday is the last opportunity to bring in items for the Respect Life baby shower and put them in the crib. Also, next Sunday's collection is the last time to turn in the All Souls Day envelopes to enroll deceased loved ones in our Novena of Masses for All Souls Day. Additional envelopes are at the doors, but next Sunday is the deadline for that one. Also, our young adult ministry for all 18 to 30-something, there's a column of things coming up, and one of them is next Saturday, an opportunity to come together for Mass, witness and prayer on the sidewalk before the Lovering Center in Greenland, as part of the 40 Days for Life that will come to an end next weekend. And then there'll also be an opportunity for those who want to linger for some breakfast and fellowship. So that's next Saturday, beginning with 8 o'clock Mass, and all 18 to 30-something are welcome. And lastly, as we mentioned last week, our church is not topped with crosses, but with new posts awaiting the beautiful new crosses that will soon be installed. We're expecting them to be placed on the bell tower and on the facade of the church early in November. However, from now until the start of Advent, so basically from now till Thanksgiving, if you would like to help with that project, but you'd also like to have your family name, whether it's all of you now, part of the community as we conclude the restoration effort and crown it with the crosses, or whether it's deceased relatives and friends, just simply jot those names down, placing them in an envelope, and just put tower and drop it in the collection. We will place all of those in a receptacle that then will be placed in the tower beneath the cross, so that for now and all the years and decades that cross will be there, each time we glance up at it or hear the bells call us to prayer, we'll be reminded. Also, I don't know if you realize it, but every night at 8 o'clock we have the De Profundis bell. The bell tolls, and that is the last ring of the day, and it's in memory and prayer for all those who were a part of this community, all those who were its founders, benefactors, builders, supporters. And so certainly, if you would like to have those names up in the tower, just simply put that in an envelope and drop it in the basket no later than Thanksgiving, and we will happily include them. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in
peace.
Thanks
be to God.
Please sing together number 417, The Church's One Foundation, number 417.